Two things to notice. The World Series just concluded. The Chicago Cubs were not in it, regrettably, because that's one of my favorite teams. But this year, the Cubs went farther into the playoff series than they had in many years. And so there's hope for the future for the Cubs. And the Cubs leads us to what we're going to be talking about this morning, or rather, our guest is going to be talking about, Leanne Walker Young, who is the daughter of a fine Major League Baseball player and coach. I'm not going to step on her toes any more than that. She'll tell you her story and his story, and that's our presentation this morning. Ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much for bringing me here. I'm honored. You're going to have to give me a minute for my nerves to settle down and the spirit to come in and take over, to tell you about this spiritual journey that I've been on, that carried me through baseball and through the grief of getting over the fact that I lost my father. So the main thing that I guess I want to start with today is just, well, let me acknowledge my mother. I'd like to, she's here, she's not here today. She's, of course, when you do things like this, your child gets sick. I have an 8-year-old who's sick at home with grandma, and that's her very favorite thing to do is be grandma. So she's there today with my children, and she has, her love and dedication to me through all of this has sustained me, and I just wanted to give her a shout out even though she's not here. She's a wonderful woman, most of you know her. Willie LaFevers has already come up to me and made me cry. He's told me a story about my dad, and I know that many of you might have a story, and if you do, I'd love to hear it afterwards, because those are the kind of things, this is a hometown crew, and you guys have some really great stories about my dad and my uncle. So we're going to start, and I've never done the PowerPoint presentation and the speaking at the same time, and so we're going to try this. This is, you're my first people. So my father was, he played with the Cubs organization all his life. It was Verlon Walker. Now there is some Rube confusion is what I like to call it. Some of you are here because of my uncle, who was the oldest brother of the Walker family. And then my dad was the middle brother, and they were both called Rube. And so this has caused, in my quest, this has caused a little bit of confusion along the way, just because people will send me things or tell me stories, and I actually find out it's really my uncle that they're referring to. But my father played for the Chicago Cubs organization all his life. He left Lenoir High School before he graduated in 1956 and was in their minor league farm team for till 1961, when he was promoted to the Cubs as part of the College of Coaches. And he was there until 1972, when he died during spring training from leukemia. He was 42 years old, and I was 3. Now the stadium that's right outside is named in honor of both my uncle and my dad. And my uncle had a really long career in baseball. He was a more well-known. He was the pitching coach for the Mets when they won the World Series. He was the catcher for the Brooklyn Dodgers when they won the World Series. As a matter of fact, he called the shot heard around the world. He called that pitch, that Bobby Thompson home run. That was my uncle who did that. Something he had to talk about for his entire life and live down. But he was catching behind Roy Campanella at that time. So he had a long career in baseball, much longer than my dad. And you can see that they both were catchers, which is kind of the quarterback of the baseball team. And it's kind of the garb they have to wear and what they have to go through is amazing, I think, as far as a catcher. I feel like this is coming back at me. Never had so much electronics around me. I gotta figure all this out. My quest started basically out of a, I guess, my, what I call father hunger. I didn't grow up with a father, and I lost him when I was three. So for me, it wasn't really a loss, it was a lack, a void. I never had him. So I wanted to get to know him. And it started when I turned 42. And that was the age that my father was when he died. And that was a really prominent time for me. Just it hit me all of a sudden that I had lived to the age that my father was when he died. And that seemed really young at the time. When you turn 42, I think this is a really young time to go. And I also had a child that was three, the same age that I was when my father died. So it kind of converged, this timing converged, and it really hit me. My husband at the time gave me a baseball glove and said, with an inscription that said, "A coach's daughter ought to have her own glove." And I opened that card and it just hit me. I am a coach's daughter. I am a coach's daughter. I'd never worn that title. And I would like to tell you that I got up, I rolled up my sleeves, and I dove into the grief, and I hit my quest. But what I really did was take to the bed with Google. And I did some research, and the grief just rolled over me. It knocked me down. And I began searching. I remember I Googled long-term effects of a father's death. And what I found is that when your father dies very young, you have great scars that go on for decades. Because I felt I had this almost, I felt really like I should be over it by now. I'm 42 years old, I'm a grown woman. I should have mourned my father. I should be further along. I should have figured this out. And what really occurred is I never did any of that. I never grieved, I never thought about him, I never talked about him. So when I got to that age, it hit me. And I became, since I had no memory of him, I thought he was almost a ghost to me. And it made sense at that point that I had these deep scars that I was, and I found out that the younger that you are when that happens, the deeper the scars. So I was on a website and I saw this, this man had done all this research, and it said, the main question he asked was, would you give up a year of your life for one day with your father? And I thought, yes, I would do that. And I found out that 73% of the people that he asked also said yes. So that made me feel like I wasn't alone, that I had some significant grief, and it was validated. And at that point, I decided that I would take a year. If I would give up a year, then I was going to take a year and I was going to get to know my dad. And I thought I would get to know him through baseball. That was his passion. You get to know people through what they love and what they do with their life and how they spend their time. And that's the way he spent his time, and that was a great passion. So I decided I was going to go into baseball, and through him I was going to get to know him. And that's when I launched my website, Baseball Love Story. That was 2012. And I figured at the time, I thought, I'm going to go on this journey, and hopefully it's going to heal me. I didn't really know where it would take me. I didn't know if anyone would respond. I didn't know what I was going to find. But I talk about it as, it was like putting a canoe in a river. I just put my canoe in the river, and I let the current take me. And I wasn't exactly sure where it would take me. I wasn't exactly sure what I would find. But I started with what I had, and what I had were a lot of pictures, a lot of black and white pictures. I had a pair of glasses, so I'd put on his glasses. I had a ring, I'd put his ring on. I had a lighter, an engraved lighter, because I think everybody at that time smoked. And I would touch it and carry it around in my pocket. And then it occurred to me that I didn't have his voice. I didn't know what his voice sounded like. And that was really archetypal for me. There's something about the fatherly voice. And I think if you, all of you, stop and just think for a minute the sound of your father's voice, you can probably remember whether he was imparting wisdom or giving you a hard time or nagging you about doing something. You can remember and hear the sound of your father's voice. And that kind of resonates with you for the rest of your life. Even when your father's gone, you can probably call on that. And I didn't have that. I didn't have his voice. And I thought, well, I'll just call the Cubs organization and surely they'll have a broadcast, a radio broadcast of his voice, and they'll send it to me. And WGN will, you know, that'll be it. They'll just send it to me on a jump drive or whatever, and it'll be fine. So I called the Cubs and I called WGN and they didn't have anything. So I reached out to Pat Hughes, who was the play-by-play announcer for the Chicago Cubs at the time, and sent him an email. And about a month after I'd sent the email, he sent me an email back that simply said, "I will help you. Give me a call." He gave me his phone number. And I was like a schoolgirl. I sat down, I couldn't wait, I put the time that he told me, and I gave him a call, and he said, "Look, WGN taped over all that stuff. It was on reel to reel, it was expensive, we didn't keep that stuff. It was right at the time before cassette was being used in the 70s when it kind of switched over. So in the 60s they didn't keep a whole lot of stuff, so your chances of finding something are pretty slim to none. Maybe a collector has something, somebody in an old dusty box somewhere in the attic might have it. I'm gonna put you in touch with some collectors and some baseball people and you can see." And that's what I did. I didn't get discouraged. I allowed the momentum to carry me. I thought, there's something out there. Someone has something. And I began to contact players. I made a commitment at that point when Pat Hughes called me back or talked to him. I made a commitment that anyone who gave me a lead, I was going to follow it. If somebody told me to call the baseball museum in Detroit, Michigan, that there was a man back there who was 85 years old who had been, you know, taping videos all his life, I was going to do it. And so I did. I talked to baseball players. I talked to Hall of Famers. I talked to broadcasters. The Baseball Hall of Fame actually put, they have huge archives that are donated, and they put an intern on it for me one summer, just looking through things that have been donated. People donate things to the Baseball Hall of Fame, and a lot of times they don't know what they have until they look through it and catalog it. So the other thing that this standing in front of people is difficult for me, talking. I'm an introvert, as well as cold calling somebody on the phone that I don't know, like Fergie Jenkins, Hall of Famer, call him up on his cell phone and say, "My name is Leanne. My dad was Verlon Walker. Do you remember him?" And that just would just unglue me. You know, I would practice it and I had to push myself to do it, and I was rewarded. It was being vulnerable, I guess, is the best way I can say. Just putting myself out there, allowing my canoe, the current, to take my canoe down the river a little further. I've been rewarded for that, because what has come back to me is that every one of these people have given me a little piece of my dad. They all told me a story. They all gave me something. And I would tell them, if you know he liked sunflower seeds, then tell me that, because I don't know. There's nothing that's insignificant to me about him. He's a ghost in my life. I don't have any connection to him. He died before his work with me was done. And so I need to know him. I'm on this soul mission, because I have a hole in my soul the size of my father, and I need you to fill it up. And these men would just take me on, basically. And I called it my team. I assembled a team and I felt like they were advancing the runner. I was going forward, propelling my mission forward, and each one of them would give me some beautiful little memory. And in return, they got to travel back in time. And what I found is they enjoyed talking about their time in baseball and their time as young men. And going back in time with me, they enjoyed that as well. So I became, after I'd talked to four or five of them, especially I got the Hall of Famers out of the way, Fergie Jenkins and Billy Williams. And then as I got further down the list, there were men like Chris Krug, who baseball had forgotten. He was a catcher, and he had moved to Los Angeles, California, and he had worked on the movie Field of Dreams and with Kevin Costner. And I called him up and I said, "Chris, my name is Leanne. My dad was Verlon Walker." And he said, "That was my coach. I remember." This is 40 years later, and I thought, that's amazing that he would remember right off my dad. And then Chris said, "Well, who else have you talked to?" And so I would tell him, "I've talked to Don Kessinger, and I've talked to Joey Amalfitano, and he lives in San Francisco, and he works for the Giants now." And so Chris would say, "Well, can you give me his phone number? I haven't talked to Joey in forever." So at that point, I realized I felt almost like this became a little spiritual mission that I was being used to connect these men that baseball had kind of forgotten. And together, I was connecting them back to their past. They were giving me something, and I was giving them something in return. So it became a really beautiful mission for me. And now they circle back and they call me and they say, "What have you heard? Who have you talked to? I found a picture," and they'll send me the copy of the picture. So it's become, I really do feel like I've assembled this amazing team and almost become my father's voice in that respect. I'm using this to keep myself on track because I have a tendency to go off track. Kevin Lefevers, where are you, Kevin? You came forward with this beautiful picture of my dad. And I say this because every person that's given me something has been so important to me. Kevin came to my house one day when I was here with my mom, and he gave me this color picture of my dad. And everyone had told me how blue my father's eyes were, and I'd never seen them in person. I didn't know what they looked like. And a lot of the pictures I had were black and white, and if they were color, they were teeny tiny and kind of not really great. And Kevin shows up at my house one day with this picture of my dad and his ice blue eyes. And it was like he gave me this gift of my father's eyes. And I'll show you this picture. I've got it. Well, I thought I had it. Maybe I've got it right here. I'm going to pass some of these pictures around. This is it. This is a picture of his eyes. And I'm just going to pass this around. You can just pass some of those around. So as insignificant as that was to Kevin, didn't realize he was doing that, but he came forward with that picture, and it is one of my most cherished pictures of my father, because it's like he's looking right at me. I started calling Greg Carlton was the bat boy for the Chicago Cubs for a long, long time, for 12 years, and he found my website and sent me an email and said, "I knew your dad, and I was a young kid, and he was nice to me. I was in the locker room, and some of those men were not so nice. I was in the way. I was, you know, they'd bark orders at me, and your dad called me his fishing buddy. He would see me coming, and he'd say, 'Here comes my fishing buddy,' and he would throw balls with me. He would talk to me. He sat down next to me. And he told me this story about when my dad was sick and he came back from, my dad was in remission for a couple of years with leukemia, and he didn't tell anyone he was sick. And but the equipment manager knew he was sick, and therefore the bat boy knew he was sick. And he told me that all that time he never acted like he didn't want anyone to know he was sick. He didn't want any attention called to himself. And he was always so upbeat and happy and just blissed out to be there. And Greg Carlton was the bat boy, and he asked him one time, he said, "Why, Mr. Walker, why do you get here so early? You get here all, you know, you're so early, you don't have to be here right now." And he said, "Because I can't wait to put on this uniform every day." He was just so happy to be playing a boy's game for profession. I think he was just so happy to be where he was. And I've learned a lot from that, just that gratitude of being right where you are, being grateful for what you have, is real important. So all these stories were, I layered flesh on bone, basically. I gave, you know, he was a ghost to me, I didn't really know him, and everybody gave me a little piece of him about his wit and his humor. And then Keith Oberman found my story. The press loved my story. The Chicago Tribune about me and a daughter in search of her father's voice. The Chicago Tribune did a story on me. The Lenore News Topic did a story on me two times. Thank you. And the Charlotte Observer. I've been on Rocky Brooks. Y'all know him? Y'all know his show? He allowed me. I emailed Rocky and I said, "Can I talk? Can you help me get my story out?" And he said, "Of course. Can you be here Wednesday at such and such a time?" And I said, "I will." And he was one of the first people that talked to me, so I'll forever be grateful for you, Rocky. And then Keith Oberman from ESPN, who is an avid baseball fan, a huge Mets fan, actually knew my uncle and my dad growing up as a boy, did a big piece on me on ESPN. And that was like a watershed moment for my little tiny blog, because all of a sudden sports talk radio wanted to talk to me in Chicago, and people who I could never get in touch with, who wouldn't return my calls, they all of a sudden wanted to talk to me. And that was really great, because I got into the Mets organization. I got into a lot of places where I couldn't normally go. Thank you, Keith Oberman. And he took an interest in my sweet little story. And I got hundreds of emails from people that had known both my father and my uncle. And a very interesting byproduct began to happen as a result of my quest. Because I was on this quest searching for baseball memorabilia and my dad's voice. And what happened is after that, a lot of women started following my blog that had also lost their father when they were young. And they were following me as I went through this journey of healing my soul and learning about my dad. And they were interested in the books that I was reading and the research that I was finding out and how I was walking through that process. And so I call us lost stars, because there's a lot of us out there. And on Veterans Day especially, it's nice to just have a moment and think about all the men and women fighting in different places who don't come home, and they leave little girls and little boys left to pick up the pieces. There's a ripple effect that happens as a result of that. I felt it in my own life. And there's a lot of little lost stars out there. And so we started communicating with each other and helping each other, became sort of a support group as a result of that, the publicity. Once I had brought him to me, I realized that I had actually gotten to know my father through baseball when I had this dream about him. And my dream was, I was sitting in a pickup truck with him, And he was in the driver's seat, and he had on this leather jacket with kind of a fur collar, and he had a styrofoam cup, and the steam was rising from the cup like it was coffee. And it was warm like flesh and breath, and I could feel him there, and he turned to me and smiled, and he didn't say anything. But I felt him. It was like I felt his presence. I knew what kind of person he was, what kind of man he was. And there was a difference. This was about a year later. I'd been on this whole journey from not knowing him to dreaming about him, where I felt like he had come to me. And that was a big point for me. I realized I had healed my soul. I had gone into baseball. These men had given me stories. They had talked to me about him, a place that he loved, a place where he spent a lot of his time and gave of himself, and they gave back to me. 40 years later, they told me stories and gave me this dream. I did find a recording of his voice right here in Caldwell County. After I had gone all around, spent 2 years looking in Chicago and Mesa, Arizona, and I'd exhausted everything I had, every lead anybody had told me, I had contacted these people. I had talked to collectors all over the United States, and Reverend Joe Parker from South Lenore Methodist Church is what that's where he was the minister. It's now Trinity Church. He came forward with a cassette tape when my father introduced New York Yankees second baseman Bobby Richardson. He invited Bobby Richardson to speak here at the church, and my father introduced him. And lo and behold, they had broadcast that, I believe, on WJRI, and there was a recording. So it was about 90 seconds of my father's voice, and it was found right here at home. And my mom presented it to me. She had it made into a DVD or a DVD player. And she handed it to me. I sat down and I listened to it by myself. And the first thing I thought of was, that doesn't sound like what I had imagined in my head. I thought that he would have a lower voice, more grovelly. I think I just thought of a baseball player, this man's man. And his voice was a little bit higher and a little bit sweeter and a little bit, it was just calm. And now I've listened to it, you know, hundreds of times, this 90 seconds, because it's all I have of his voice. And I'm going to try not to cry. That's my goal at the end of this, is to not cry through this. And that's my one goal, because I don't look very pretty when I cry. So I'm still looking. I feel like there could be some more audio of his voice out there, something where he's cracking a joke or, you know, telling a story, which would be great. This was just an introduction, but it gave me just that last little piece. After I had the dream and felt like I knew him and I got to know his personality, it was what I yearned for. And I found it at home all along. But the most important thing was, when looking back, as I think about my canoe in the current and how this spiritual journey has propelled me through baseball and taken me away from home, it took my father away from home. It showed him the world. It gave him incredible stories. I circled all the way back around, and I'm so glad that when I called the Cubs, they didn't have the audio. I'm glad that I had that journey, because it's the journey that healed me. It wasn't the voice. I've had a lot of people ask me what I thought about when I heard his voice. And the main thing I can tell you, it was bittersweet almost. It was like I had gone on this quest, and I thought, once I get that, I'll be okay. And what really has happened is that I'm never going to actually have what I yearn for, which is this father hunger of him. And all the fathers out there, you guys know how important you are to your daughters. It's like you just have no idea how much ground you give them. And without you in their lives, they kind of float around lost. And fathers ground daughters right in, that you give them this little piece of real estate underneath their feet, that they go forward and they carry themselves in a secure and safe way. And without that, you kind of have to find your own way as a woman, as a girl. And no one can give you that except your dad. So I'm never gonna get that. I'm always gonna, I've done all the healing I can do in the doing. There's nothing more for me to do except to accept what I have and this beautiful legacy of this man that baseball has given me. I'm lucky, actually, that baseball has given me this. The last part of my story is that I went to Chicago, and my goal for going to Chicago, I had three goals. I wanted to see where he played. I wanted to go to Wrigley Field. I wanted to see the city that he loved and where he spent a lot of time away from home. I wanted to see the place where he died, because he died in Northwestern Hospital. And I wanted to meet all of these people that had helped me. And like the good Southerner that I am, I wanted to look them in the eyes and hug their neck and thank them for all of their kindness, because it was amazing to have them open up their arms and do work for me. They scoured eBay for me. They talked to collectors for me and gave of themselves. So I went to see Pat Hughes in the WGN press box, and he let me come up there on Wrigley Field and hug him. And I got to sit in the dugout where my dad sat in Wrigley Field. And I will tell you this, all I did was get myself to Chicago. I just bought a plane ticket and I got myself there, and the rest was spiritually, divinely organized. Major League Baseball, MLB Network, followed me around with a film crew, and they asked to do that. If I would have called MLB Network, they probably would have never answered my phone call. But they came to me as a result, I guess, of Oberman, and they followed me around with a film crew, and I got to, and they did a piece on me. And we went to the Rube Walker Blood Center, which still exists today, and it's at Northwestern Hospital, and it was part of a donation that the Cubs gave $35,000 when my father died. And the proceeds from the Crosstown Classic, when the White Sox play the Cubs, the proceeds go to the Rube Walker Blood Center. Now it's called Cubs Care, the charity for cancer. And still some of that money goes to this center, but it still exists today. And I went there and they treated me like Princess Diana. They rolled out the red carpet and I got to speak to patients and the nurses. And at the time, the first year, they did about 40 treatments, and now they do thousands. And so something, you know, again, the legacy that my father created through baseball in this little small town, Caldwell County, didn't graduate from high school, man. Now there's a blood center named after him that heals people every day from they have this incredible machine called a centrifuge that filters their own blood out and gives them their stem cells back. I mean, it's just amazing. He would be so blissed out that is in his honor. This is the film crew from MLB's that followed me around. When I walked into Northwestern Hospital, and there was actually a plaque that said the Rube Walker Blood Center, I could not believe it. I just wanted to take a picture of that, just because that was an amazing, I'd gotten myself there, and I never paid attention to it, I never thought about it, and I don't think many people know about that around Caldwell County, but just the fact that that is there and still exists, and the nurses tell me that people come in there and they remember my dad. They'll come in, there's a picture of him on the wall, and they'll will them in there, and they'll say, I remember this guy, I remember Rube Walker as the pitching coach for the Chicago Cubs. 40 years later. What I've learned from my journey, from my soul mission, a couple of things that have been real important to me. The first thing is that there's this magic of things work so much better if I get out of the way. If when you put your canoe in the water and you let angels push you from behind in anything you do in life, and don't neurose about it and worry over it and fix it and manipulate it, things really turn out so much better. So if I get out of the way, most of the time, spirit, God, whatever you call it, a source of pure positive energy will work through you and bring you incredible gifts beyond what you could make happen for yourself. When I started this, when I was laying in the bed Googling long-term effects of a father's death on a daughter, and I thought, would I give up a year of my life to know him for one day? And I said yes. That was a dark moment in my life, and all I did was get myself up out of the bed and say, I am going to heal, and I'm going to get to know my dad. And the rest has come to me. I've attracted it to me as if I just said, please, I need help. I need something. I need to fill this void. And it's come to me. Another lesson is the power of being vulnerable. And Brené Brown, who is a writer, she talks about how vulnerability is the birthplace of creativity. And what I didn't know is that it's where everything else hangs out. My vulnerability, in order for me to be vulnerable and ask for help, it's not what any of us want to do. We don't want to show that we need help or that we need someone or that we don't know how to do something. But it's actually where all the good stuff is. All the happiness, all the sweetness, all the power, all the spirit. We can't really get close to the spirit unless we're vulnerable. And what we like to do is wear our armor around, which I was doing for 40 years. I always had my 10 tons of armor, and I couldn't figure out why I felt so bad. And the minute I opened up and allowed the spirit in and allowed all this to come into me, I felt better. It healed me. The only thing that endures is your kindness. The legacy of kindness. People don't remember anything else. That's what's really been important to me. When I would call these men, they remembered my dad 40 years, 50 years later, some of them in the minor leagues, and they remember how kind he was. They remember how funny he was. They remember sweet things that he did. One of my favorite stories was Blake Cullen was the traveling secretary for the Chicago Cubs, and I called him, and he remembers that when he started with the Chicago Cubs as the traveling secretary, he had all these books, and he had a book bag, and he had a briefcase, and he had this big recorder that he had to carry around with him, and it was all this stuff, and he didn't have an assistant, and so he was carrying it all, and my dad came up behind him, took his briefcase and his big recorder from him, and put it in the overhead bin in his compartment and took it and said, you know, then when we got to their station, he said, where's your room? And my dad carried his recorder and his briefcase to the room for him. And from then on, in every away game, my dad would send the bat boy, Greg Carlton, up to the stands to retrieve Blake Cullen's recorder and his briefcase, so that he would bring it down and my dad would be responsible for taking that with him so that Blake wouldn't have to carry all that. And he did that because he was nice. Nobody was watching. And that to me showed more about his character than a lot of the other stories that I learned. And that little piece of kindness has endured for 40 years. So it's the kindness that you show people and the way that you treat them is really all they remember. And the last thing is that the main thing I learned is that the journey has been more important than the treasure. all along I thought I was looking for his voice, and I thought I was looking for one particular thing, and the journey was the most important part for me. And it is with all of us, it is with most everything we do. I was looking for him, and I really found myself. And I was looking for his voice, and I really found mine. But I didn't know that at the time. And the journey is usually what we rush through and what we're trying to get. We want to get to the end. We want to get to the destination. But what I've learned from this is that the walking through it is much more important than the destination, than the actual treasure that we find. Now, I have also, I've passed around a ton of pictures, and in those pictures there was, some of you might be interested in, there were Casey Stengel with the Mets, and Frank Robinson, and different people, and I can pass around some more of these, and I'll also take any questions that anybody has, if anybody has any questions about my journey, or my dad, or my uncle. And as usual, my website is baseballlovestory.com, but if you have any stories, these are hometown stories, and I've found out that this is baseball-rich country, and that baseball players have the best stories. That's another thing I learned through my all this journey, that I don't know if it's the sitting around, there's a lot of spitting and just sitting. Especially the pitchers that have to sit for 5 days and then they go back and they rotate in and out and they sit around and the relief pitchers, they sit around, they talk, and I think they tell stories and the stories get bigger and bigger and bigger. But I know that baseball players have great stories. So anyway, if anybody has any questions or anything that they would like to say, I would love to stick around. I know that we have to go and talk about the veterans, go honor the veterans up on the square as well. Does anybody have any questions?
Why were they both called Rube?
That's a good question. She asked me, why were they both called Rube? My uncle Rube was the oldest, and he followed around this minor league player called Rube Robinson. And they started calling my uncle Little Rube. And so when he went into the major leagues, he had just adopted that name, Rube. And then my dad did as well. So it was just a complete nickname. Now I know some people say a Rube is like a redneck, ignorant person. So I've had to fight that as well, because there were no rednecks and ignorant people around here. But that's what it was, Rube Robinson. So it did create lots of confusion, but I think my dad wanted to be just like his older brother, who was the stoic, athletic one. I think he was actually a quarterback for the Lenoir High School football team as well, my uncle. That's a good question. Anybody else?
Is Leslie still alive?
Leslie is not still alive. He died, I think, three or 4 years ago.
He worked for me in the truck stop.
He worked for everybody. She asked if my Uncle Leslie was still alive. He asked if my Uncle Leslie was still alive. He had Uncle Leslie Walker, was the youngest brother of the Walkers. And he stayed in Lenoir. I don't think he ever left Caldwell County, not even for a vacation. He vacationed in Roadhiss, I believe. That's where he went, Lake Roadhiss. And loved every minute of it. Lake James, he went fishing. He nurtured baseball here at the grassroots level. And actually, my Uncle Rube, the oldest brother, he even said that he thought Leslie had the most raw baseball talent of the brothers. But he never wanted to leave. He did not want to leave Caldwell County. He didn't want to go outside. So he stayed here, and he was an umpire. He was a little league coach, which he dearly loved. And he would fix baseball gloves. So everybody had a place in the baseball world, in the Walker family.
He almost got killed when he worked for me. He was changing a truck tire and they had rims on them. And when he inflated, the rim flew up and hit him in the face.
He was just saying that he, my Uncle Leslie almost got killed because he was changing a tire improperly. Spirit saved him. God bless him. Anybody else?
Lynn, when you first contacted the Cubs, were they receptive, very receptive to your call or dismissive to some degree?
They were actually very receptive, and they remembered my dad, and they remembered the leadoff man, which was WGN's big pre-game and post-game interview session. And I even told them, my dad played with Leo DeRocha, and I don't know if any of you know him, but he was very polarizing. Either you loved him or you hated him. He was he could be a terrible person, married, I don't know, four times. But I said he did interviews when Leo didn't want to, and they remembered, yes, I believe he did. So they were very receptive. They were very helpful. Yes, I was pleased. Thank you. Yes.
I remember one year from my youth, back when the Cubs weren't very good, they did not have a manager. Each coach managed for 1 month. Was your dad in that group at that time?
Yes, the question is, the coach, it was the College of Coaches, is the name of that, where when the Cubs weren't very good, there was a rotating College of Coaches, and P.K. Wrigley, who owned the team at the time, decided he was going to do that, and it was ill-fated from the very beginning. But I love it because it's what brought my father to the big leagues. Bob Kennedy was on that rotating manager side. There were five of them, and he said, "There's this great guy in the minor leagues, and his name's Verlon Walker. He's really good with the young kids. He's really good with." Young batters and pitchers, we're going to bring him up and be part of the College of Coaches. It lasted 1 year, I believe. And significant, which I think is significant, all of those coaches were fired except for my dad. He stayed for the whole time. And I think in 1964, my Uncle Leslie told me this, in 1964, my dad went to P.K. Wrigley and said, I want to be manager. It's time. I've been here for 3 years. I've outlasted all these people. It's time to make me the manager of the Cubs. And P.K. Wrigley looked at him and said, "I can't do that, Verlon, because then I might have to fire you. And I don't want to do that." He wanted to keep him on. And P.K. Wrigley actually flew my dad on his private jet back and forth when he needed treatment the first time when he was in, before he went into remission. So, anybody else?
How much older was your
uncle than your dad? There was my Uncle Rube and my dad, there was 6 years between them. So there was a pretty big age difference, yeah. Anybody else?
Let me ask a question.
Yes.
That 90-second clip of your father's voice, now it's accessible somewhere, isn't it?
It is. It's on my website, baseballlovestory.com. It's on there. And I think you guys have a link of it? No? The news topic doesn't. I can send it to you.
It'll be in this video.
It's going to be in the video. This one.
In real time. What Bill Tate is saying is that what he has shot this morning will be enhanced with that recording, which he will edit. Bill has amazed me with his skill with audio and visual effects. And we appreciate it. So a DVD will be forthcoming.
Okay.
And he will have that audio clip in there. And if you want one, there will be a method to get one.
At the gift shop. Is that right?
We want to thank you.
Thank you so much for coming. I'm so honored.
Hi, I'm Bill Tate, and I'm in Lower Creek. And today I'm with Ann Walker and Leanne Young, and we're doing a little video about the old times with Verlon Walker and Rube Walker.
Well, Mom, tell me how you met.
He came home in 56. in September from being with the his ball club, and he came home for the winter, and one evening I received a telephone call from him, and at that time I could not place who Verlon Walker was, and he said that his cousin, one of his cousins, gave him my telephone number, and he was calling to ask me to go to the football game with him on Friday night at Lenore High School, and this was on a Wednesday. So I accepted, and we went to the ball game, and that was our first date. And of course, we saw each other continuously that winter while he was home. And then he left the next season to go to Paris, Illinois, the minor leagues, or the sponsor, the Cubs sponsored that ball team, and he was the player manager there. So we corresponded, and he called most every evening.
And he wrote letters.
Yeah, he wrote letters.
I found beautiful love letters. Simple boy from Caldwell County writing beautiful love letters to you.
Now, Ann, were you working at Lenore Drug when you met your husband?
No, I had, I worked at Lenore Drug for 48 and 49, and then my next position was with Louis Dysart at First Union. He came in to Lenore Drug most every morning for coffee. He'd have coffee, and one morning he asked me if I would like to work at the bank.
See, I didn't know that. You didn't tell me that. He lured you away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I went, had an interview, and I was hired, and so I worked off and on with First Union. Of course, they merged later, and I retired in 1988 from, I believe it was First Citizens Bank at that time. So, and then, but getting back to our courtship, it was on for 9 years. He would come home and we'd date, but I couldn't lure him into taking me back with him.
I know. Why didn't he ask you? For 9 years, that was unusual. That is not unusual now, but it was in the 60s.
Mm-hmm. Well, he said baseball wasn't an ideal career for marriage because you were gone more than 50% of the time. But and even in the winter time, sometimes you were gone until Christmas, or maybe, and then you'd start back in February for spring training. Mm-hmm. So.
And baseball players didn't make what they make now.
No, not nearly
as much.
This was
before free agency and all that stuff.
Yeah. It was more of a family-oriented game at that time. And but I couldn't convince him. So in 1966, we were married January 30th. And that next year, I went to spring training. That was the first year they had spring training in California, Palm Beach. But that wasn't suitable because they couldn't practice in the mornings because of the dew on the grass. So they went back to Mesa, Arizona.
What was that like? You left Lenore and you went out to, had you ever been out west or anything like that?
I had never been really any farther away from home than the beach, Myrtle Beach and mm-hmm. Carolina Beach. Mm-hmm. So,
were you scared?
No, I was too grateful to be going to the big city. Mm-hmm. So I really enjoyed it. And
you weren't scared in Chicago?
No. When they'd go on road trips the first year, my telephone bill calling my friends in Lenore was a little bit higher.
You were homesick.
I was a little homesick. But that was before you were with me, mm-hmm. so that helped when he was gone.
What did your friends think that you were, because you were the last one to marry of all your girlfriends, and then all of a sudden you got to leave town and you were with a baseball player.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was something new for me, but I enjoyed it all, and I soon learned to get around in Chicago alone when he was gone. So you and I did a lot of running around, mm-hmm. and I met so many people in Chicago that was from Lenore. There was a lady that worked at Doula Hospital, Martha Sutcliffe, and she had married a fella from Irving. Well, it was a suburb of Chicago. I can't recall. We still correspond with him. Martha passed away, and he has two daughters. So we had fun there, and of course Park Ridge. I met some people in Park Ridge, and it was a wonderful opportunity for me to. So that
didn't
is
you a, meet? Didn't you, weren't you in the same place with Frank Sinatra once? Tell me about that. A restaurant or something. Or was it Dean Martin?
That was in California, yes. Dean Martin and Frank Sinatra. And, of course, I was a fan of them. And this was when Leo DeRocher was the manager of the Cubs. Mm-hmm. So they were known as the Rat Pack. And they did... I did meet them, and I was excited, a little country girl meeting my ideal singers, really. Mm-hmm. So,
what about Leo DeRocher? How did you feel about him?
He and I got along real good. I found out that he did give Verlon a hard time the first year, I think, but it didn't take but 1 year, and Verlon had won him over. So,
yeah, Leo inherited him. This is what I learned, and mm-hmm. and the PK Wrigley made Leo keep my dad.
Mm-hmm.
He said, "You will keep Verlon Walker,"
mm-hmm.
and so that.
Well, that was when the seven coaches disbanded that 1 year, so he did. He did give Verlon, and he had given him a contract in for 71, but this was in the spring of 70. But of course,
for the pitching coach, he was going to be the pitching
mm-hmm,
coach.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That was his dream. That's what he wanted, right? That was his dream job, was to be the pitching coach?
Yes, and he used to kid Leo. He said, "And maybe one day I'll be the manager." Just kidding with him. But they got along real good. And Leo, he was very nice to me. In fact, he helped me out with when Verlon... the last few months when he didn't feel too good, he would be lenient with him. So
he came to see him in the hospital, right?
He'd visit him in the hospital, so
he had a soft side, no matter what they've written about him.
Well, that's true.
Leo.
Yeah, and in fact, when we were in California, he Leo had a car that he wanted to get from Chicago to back to his home. And so, not from Chicago, I'm sorry, from California, it was to LA, and so he asked Verlon to take his car home. He couldn't get it there himself, and I tried to follow him, but I missed a turn, and we did get lost. I did, from Verlon, and that was before cell phones, so I thought, how am I going to find him in California?
You got separated from following him. Was he driving too fast?
No, it was a turn, and a car got in front between, because I wasn't following too close, and so a car got in between, and so then I couldn't make the turn that he did.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew, how was I going to turn around? And so I told my mother when she called, I said I was stuck on the freeway and I had no idea how I was going to get back to meet Verlon. And she told someone in Lenore, said my mom was on the freeway, and I really don't know what that meant, but
she didn't know what the freeway meant.
No, so.
Oh yeah, I guess not.
So we had a wonderful 5 years, and the most exciting time was having our daughter, and he doted on you, and in the wintertime, you and he had a good time together.
Mm-hmm.
So,
tell me about 1969, when Uncle Rube was on the pitching coach for the Mets, and my dad was the third base coach for the Cubs, and they were playing each other for the National League pennant. And the Cubs went into it with a winning record. They were going into August winning the division. And the Mets ended up beating them, going to the World Series and winning. Over. So tell me about how that kind of went with two brothers.
Well, of course, that was a sad time for Verlon. We came home after the season ended, and
after he lost to Uncle Rube.
That time when, and of course Rube got to stay and play in the series, mm-hmm. and winning, but Verlon didn't talk about it very much. If I mentioned it, he'd change the subject. But when we got home, he had some fishing buddies and hunting buddies that they always went fishing, and for the whole series, I think he was home two nights, and he would not watch the ball game. But they were still friends, and he was happy for Rube and the Mets.
Bittersweet, but, I guess.
Yes, it was. So, but it wasn't. You know, he's. Soon got over that, and 70 was a good season for them. But of course, they lost in the last few games, mm-hmm. as usual. When the season got near the end, that's when they sort of went downhill. So,
and
but
then,
maybe this year might be a little different. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping.
They made the playoffs,
and Ernie Banks said not 15 would be the year for the Cubs, and of course
he did.
He's not here, but mm-hmm. maybe he was correct.
Mm-hmm.
I can hope.
And so he was diagnosed with leukemia,
mm-hmm.
again. He came out of remission,
mm-hmm.
in 70, off season of 71,
mm-hmm.
or no, 70, yes. 1970.
And, yeah, in 70. And of course, he did go to spring training that year, but he was hospitalized in Mesa. And
in March, or in February.
And he had
February of 71.
Yes, and well, he played, or he coached for about 3 weeks of February, and then he was admitted into Northwestern for a procedure for exploratory, I think. And And of course, in that March of March 24th of 71, he passed away. So at that time, and they had a pretty good year that year.
71.
The Cubs did, but they're still waiting on that World Series.
Growing up, I never really talked about my dad. I never really thought about him very much. I just tried to go and not make anybody upset or sad. I didn't want to talk about Daddy because I didn't want to bring up any pain. So I just kind of held all that in. And Uncle Leslie, my uncles were like, they were surrogate dads. They would come in, and I had a lot of men in my life. I have my mother's brother who stepped in and really helped me growing up, but it was never like having my dad. And so this is my favorite picture of him. Actually, Kevin Lefevers came forward with this picture after I had started my blog, and I loved it because it showed me, people would talk about how blue his eyes were, and since I never got to see them in person, that was the first time I got to see his eyes and how watery, crystal blue they were. And so that picture is very important to me because he was very, a lot of these are black and white photos. Like this one of us at Wrigley Field is another one I love because he was smiling, and it's our family photo. Mm-hmm. And that makes me, you know, I can see his hands wrapped around my legs and touching me, and I never got that as a child to know what that would feel like. I don't remember him. So to have these moments frozen in time was real important to me. And when I turned 42, I was the same age as he was when he died. And that, it seemed like that was old to me until you turned 42, and then you're like, wow, that was no time that he had a split second in life on this earth. And what I have found in hindsight is that in those 42 years, he impacted a lot of lives. All the players that I've spoken with, the broadcasters, the people that remembered him around town, they always talked about his wit, his sense of humor, his kindness, and how he wanted to help young baseball players. That was really his role in the Cubs and in all of the baseball organizations. He really wanted to coach and help and mentor younger players, and they remember him because of that. And he, that's really what endures. That's what has shown me from my whole journey, is when people will come forward and tell me stories, that's really the only thing that is left. When he left a legacy behind, a blood center, a baseball legacy, a daughter, a wife, brothers, but he also touched a lot of lives. And the lesson for me is that to give of yourself, be vulnerable, and show kindness, and be eternally grateful. The main thing that I've gotten from all the baseball is that he was so grateful and just blissed out to be playing, to be doing what he loved for his, as a career. And I think he really understood how grateful it was. Maybe it was because he came home in the off season, and since baseball players didn't make that much, he did have to work a real job, like the pecan, right? Didn't he?
In Florence, South Carolina. He worked there in the winters.
Picking pecans and
buying the pecans.
Just
for companies.
And he did all sorts of odd jobs, and that was real work, real work. And his parents worked in the factories, and he saw what it was like in extreme poverty, and he was able to make a living playing a game that he loved as a child, and I think that that was never lost on him throughout his life. I think he died feeling very grateful for the life he had. So I have this incredible baseball collection of photographs. I have Sandy Koufax, who I'm trying to get in touch with, and I'm going to find him. He's gonna call me, because I feel like Fred Clare, who was with the Dodgers organization for a long, long time. I spoke with him. He tried to buy the Dodgers, actually, when they were up for sale, and he knew my uncle. He didn't know my father, but he knew my uncle, and he told me that baseball during this time was like a very small fraternity. All the baseball players really knew each other. They kept up with each other, and particularly the Southern boys. They kind of gathered and drifted toward one another when they were around. And so I have all these pictures of my dad with players from other teams. And so Fred Clare was the one that told me, talk to everybody, even if they haven't played specifically on the same team as your dad or your uncle. They probably knew him or knew of him. And that was really a milestone for me, because it gave me the courage to talk to anyone who came my way. And the momentum of the journey has kind of built on itself. I would talk to one person and they would say, well, have you ever talked to this guy, or do you know this person? And I would first Google them, so I would have a little background and know who I was getting ready to talk to, and then I would call them. And lo and behold, they would know a story, or they would know something. Or if they didn't know someone, didn't know my dad particularly or my uncle, they knew of someone who might. And so I've had the privilege of talking to a lot of people in baseball, of the golden age of baseball, and they've been incredibly generous with their stories. And I think part of it is they really love to go back in time as well. They like to revisit that time when baseball was simple, when it was a fraternity of sorts, and they enjoyed the game just purely for the game. And they like to go back. And some of these players, especially for the Cubs, have been kind of forgotten. They, beyond Fergie Jenkins, Ernie Banks, and a handful of others, a lot of these Cubs players really have not been celebrated. And so what was interesting to me, and from a historical standpoint too, was when I would call these people, I called this man named Chris Krug, who was a catcher during the time that my dad was there. And Chris lives in Los Angeles, and they all always left baseball and never made enough money to live for the rest of their lives, so they would start another career. And he was a landscape designer, and he actually designed the cornfield for Field of Dreams, for that movie with Kevin Costner. And he is this firecracker of a guy, and he still keeps in contact with me. And he will, I called him out of the blue, and I said, Chris Krug, this is Leanne Walker Young, and my father was Verlon Walker. Do you remember him? And immediately he said, that was my coach. I remember. And he told me a story, and I thought that was amazing, just out of the blue, catch him out of the blue, and he remembered my dad. He is so interested in my journey and has kept up with it all along. But more than that, he then turned the conversation to me and said, well, who have you talked to? And so I named the people that I'd talked to, and how are they? Tell me about them. And then inadvertently, I became my father's voice. I was looking for his voice, and then I kind of became an ambassador of sorts and connected a lot of these players to one another who had been forgotten. And so that was a beautiful kind of byproduct of my journey. I didn't expect to be instrumental at all in any sort of way, but these men have actually reached out to me again over and over and want to know who I've talked to and how are they and where they are and do I have their number or their email. So it's been, I've been able to connect some people together, and it's been really helpful for me to know that I've done something in the process of they give to me, and I'm actually giving them something as well. And so it's been a beautiful spiritual journey, I think, just based on me trying to be vulnerable and putting my putting myself out there on the internet. So I started this quest in an attempt to know kind of where I came from. And my father died when I was 3, so it wasn't a loss for me, because that would imply that I actually had him or knew him. It was more of a lack, a void. So I had this hole the size of him in my soul that I just needed to fill. And I started when I turned 42, and I really went on this search to find him, or to get to know him is what I wanted to know. I wanted to know his personality. I wanted to layer pieces of him, figure him out, and so I could pull him into me and really get to know him. So that's what I did. And I started with pictures, and my uncle Leslie, the youngest brother, gave me a lot of old baseball pictures, but this is one from Lenore High School. Oh, I'm gonna move the picture. This is Lenore High School championship picture, and my dad was on there as catcher. And this is before you knew him, right? You didn't know him in 48.
No.
And so I knew that baseball was his first love, and mom was his second love. Maybe I was
true.
Third love. So that's where baseball love story came from. It was trying to pull all three of those things together. And he was in the minors for so long, and he finally became a coach for the Cubs as part of the College of Coaches, an ill-fated, terrible idea by P.K. Wrigley to have a rotating manager, different one every game. But it got my father into the major leagues, and that's where he wanted to be. So I'll always be a fan of the College of Coaches, even though nobody else is. And so I had all these pictures, and I just began talking to people and having them tell me stories, which is kind of an oral history from a historical perspective. You get pieces of information, pieces of his personality given to you by other people. And it really has been a beautiful layering, so to speak, of him. And what's been interesting is now, after this journey, this quest, I'm starting to calling it a soul mission now, that I've been on to heal my soul of being fatherless. I know him now, and I miss him. I didn't miss him before because I didn't really know who he was. I missed the fact that I didn't have a father, that void, but now I miss who he was and what other people have told me about him. So this is me at Wrigley Field. I look mad. Do you remember when this picture was taken?
Yes.
Was I mad?
That was, you looked sad and mad.
Yeah.
Differently. All of the years from, I'd say, till you got into middle school, you had a sad look.
Yeah, I've always carried that.
And people mistook that for you were mad or upset.
Yeah, I've always I've carried a sadness with me, all my life, I really have. And this is us at Walker Stadium, Walker Field. And you say that we didn't mean to dress in red. I thought that this was...
No, it wasn't planned.
I can't believe that.
I ran into Mr. Dula that day, and we were at the Walker Field, and he offered to take that picture.
Mm-hmm. So. It's a great picture of us. I must have been 4.
Mm-hmm. 4 or 5.
This is This is a picture of the moment of silence at the first Crosstown Classic game between the White Sox and the Cubs in honor of my dad after he passed away. I have a press release that Pat Hughes sent me as well of that time, what they said on the radio. And here's Casey Stengel. Did you ever meet him?
Yes.
You met him?
Yeah, and we met when they were there with the Mets.
Yeah, I guess he knew my uncle too.
70.
And then this picture I love because it's just, it's history, it's Cubs history. It's the Black Cat. The Black Cat curse, Ron Santo in the batter's box, and a black cat comes walking past him. That was in 69? Yeah, it was 68 or 69?
69.
Were you there at the game?
No, I wasn't there that game.
I guess you were babysitting me. But
well, yeah, you went with me every time I went. But
they said that was the reason they lost. The Black Cat curse.
And there is a restaurant in Chicago, isn't it, named the Black Cat?
I don't know. There's the Billy Goat.
Oh.
The Billy Goat curse. That's a whole nother curse.
Yeah.
This is my uncle, Rube, with the Mets and me. During that, I look older there. I don't know when this was, but this was not 69. This was later.
Let's see.
I don't know when that was. We'll have to get somebody. Maybe somebody can tell us what year that was. But based on how old I was.
Well, they were there playing that year, and he was with the Mets.
For a while.
Yeah.
I'll start with the letter. This is the Lenore High School letter that was clearly never put on a sweater. And I guess he would have lettered in baseball, I'm assuming. Mm-hmm. Although Uncle Rube was he was the quarterback in the football team too. So they say that Rube was the true athlete. He was so athletic and he could do it all. He played golf. And my dad was the sportsman. He liked to fish and hunt and do all that outdoorsy stuff and baseball. So this was his letter and his stars for Lenore High School. He never did graduate from Lenore High School. He left in his senior year, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I mean, like almost he was about to graduate. This is typical Walker. In Walker fashion, he left and went to a tryout in Lumberton, North Carolina, to try out for their single A team. And when he tried out, and a little known fact that I read, a historian told me this as well, and I read it in a book, Rocky Marciano tried out as well for the catcher position. And my dad beat out Rocky Marciano for that position. And then his wit and his joke about it was he would tell people that when Rocky Marciano found out he was second place to Verlon Walker, then he began beating people up. And that's how he started his boxing career. That was his joke. But I didn't know that Rocky I have since read about him and found out that he was a baseball fan and a baseball love. He loved baseball. That was one of his loves. And then also there was this photograph of him with his early times bourbon. I heard that he was a fan of early times bourbon here, and known for having parties in his room. That's what some of the people have told me, that he enjoyed having parties and telling stories and being the center of attention and enjoying that downtime. And I've found that baseball players do have the best stories. I think it's because of all the downtime they have to sit around and wait for the next time they pitch or the next time they play. And this picture just cracks me up. It's Ron Santo, who was he's a Hall of Famer, third base, right, Mama?
Yes.
For the Cubs. He was an announcer for a long time. Never did get to talk to him. And they're giving some beauty queen pointers on her on her batting practice, her swing, I suppose. And that just kind of shows me his wit and how he was always, I think, up to doing that kind of thing, that kind of PR, which led me to always think that I would find something, you know, a radio broadcast, because I think he did enjoy that. And I'm not done. I think I will find a radio broadcast. I really believe maybe that someone in the New York media market might have done something in when the Mets and the Cubs played and had the Walker brothers on there.
I think that's it for Pensive. I have one more where she's walking.
He's got a good arm, don't you think?
Yeah, oh yeah. Part of the marriage.
That, I don't even know how that even happened.
And I'm looking towards home.
Okay. Nice.
Okay, stand by. Like this year would be the night. I always thought I wanted to be the night.
The world is full of treasure seekers. Some are dreamers who plumb the ocean floor for centuries-old pirate gold. Some follow tattered maps into mountain caves. But some, like Leanne Walker Young, are on a quest to fill the empty spaces in the soul. They look for their bounty within. Leanne is the daughter of Verlon Rube Walker, a coach for the Chicago Cubs and baseball lifer who died of leukemia in 1971 when Leanne was 3.
When I turned 42, which was how old he was when he died, it hit me that I didn't really know him. I have things of his. I have these great pictures, flat black and white pictures. And he's always been just a bit of a ghost in my life, my father, just kind of dancing in and out, me trying to figure out who he was. And when I pulled all that together, it just hit me that I'd never heard the sound of his voice. I knew that I had stored away that grief with deep pain, and I knew I had avoided it all those years because I knew to unleash it would probably cause me a lot of pain. And so I decided that I was going in. I was going to figure it out, and I wanted to heal. I wanted to just get better.
Verlon Lee Walker was born and raised in the North Carolina town of Lenoir. His older brother Albert was nicknamed Rube, and eventually so was Verlon. Albert made it to the majors, where he called the Ralph Branca pitch that Bobby Thompson hit for the shot heard round the world. Verlon played in the minors. Both would become big league coaches. Verlon got Ann Wilson's phone number from a cousin and invited her to a Lenoir High School football game. That started a courtship that lasted 9 years.
He was very good to write letters and call, so that encouraged me. I was real happy. He was very attentive. He was kind-hearted, and I mean, he was just considerate. Well, to me, he was perfect.
Leanne was born in 1968, the Walker's only child.
He just doted over her, and he would take her everywhere he went. And then he was diagnosed with leukemia in the next, it was in the next summer, in July.
Baseball love story came to me because I kept thinking about what my father loved, and I knew that his main love was baseball. He pursued it all his life. He was lucky enough to be able to make a career out of what he loved. And he loved my mom, and he loved me. I've explained it like putting a canoe in a river and just letting the current take me. I think the first thing I did was a timeline of his life. I started looking for his voice in 2013. I believe it was December 2013.
Leanne contacted WGN, the Cubs' flagship station, and they didn't have any recordings. But play-by-play man Pat Hughes and writer and historian George Castle were captivated, and names and phone numbers flooded into her inbox.
Fergie Jenkins was the first person I called, and he's a Hall of Famer, incredibly kind, soft-spoken gentleman, and he told me that he remembered my dad, and I talked to Billy Williams, and Billy Williams is a Hall of Famer, and he remembers going to see my dad in the hospital, and my dad squeezing his hand when he saw him. Sweet moments like that that I didn't know, and I would tell these men, I would say, look, I don't know my dad, so if you know that he liked sunflower seeds, that's not insignificant to me. Tell me.
Still, no recording. Leanne pressed on, but there were difficult moments.
I would be in the grocery store, and all of a sudden, something would strike me. I would see a little girl with their dad talking about cereal, breakfast cereal, and it would just unglue me, just make me sad of what I had missed.
Some seek treasures in the hulls of decaying shipwrecks or in long-forgotten mineshafts. Others find them right where they never even thought to look.
The tape was discovered in a box in my mom's house. And it was a recording that had been done in 1969, I believe, when my father had invited Yankee second baseman Bobby Richardson to come speak at a church in the off season. And my mom had been talking to a minister in town years ago and mentioned that broadcaster that time, and he had said, you know, I think I have a video or a tape of that. It used to be broadcast on the local radio stations. And so he had given it to her, and she just like stuck it away in a box.
We're very fortunate to have with us this morning Bobby Richardson, a great second baseman for the New York Yankees for many years. I told Bobby that this was great Yankee territory, so he can feel at home.
When I started this, he was a ghost, and I've kind of layered flesh on bone, so to speak, and the voice was kind of the last piece that I needed, and now it all kind of fits together for me. I always expected myself to be elated, but there was a little bit of a sadness to it, just because I'm never gonna get what I really want, which is him.
In my lifetime, I guess Bobby is the most respected player in baseball. And after Joe Parker's solo, Bobby Richardson.
A month later, Leanne had unfinished business to attend to in her father's kind of town.
My goal in going to Chicago was to see where he died, see where he lived most of his life as far as his passion, and to look these people in the eyes that had helped me along the way, meet them and thank them. And I got to do all that in a span of about 48 hours. The Rube Walker Blood Center originated with a donation from the Chicago Cubs to Northwestern Hospital on behalf of my father. The first year they were in existence, they did maybe 400 procedures, and now they're up to in the thousands, 4,000 procedures.
To me, it's a privilege just for her to come here and meet someone that the actual clinic I work in is named after her father. To me, that ties it all together.
Are there some Cubs fans in here?
Yes, well, definitely. Always.
How can she be?
Hi.
Definitely.
Hi, I'm nice Leanne. Nice to meet Leanne. You.
So you've never seen what was set up by the Cubs?
No, I've never seen
in
it.
Memory of your
Yeah, I almost cried when I walked through the door and I saw his name on the door and his picture in the lobby. Yeah.
I can't believe it. I'm just so lucky.
Yeah.
Lucky.
It's right here. You're making me cry too. I know. It's wonderful. When I went to Chicago, I got to visit the archives at Northwestern Hospital, which I didn't even know existed. And I was amazed that they have press releases, photographs, great images of all of these incredible fundraisers that happened over the years. And Sue, who is the archivist, was gracious enough to let me sift through all of it because I wanted to see every single thing.
It was letting Leanne know that if she came to Chicago, she would still see that the center is alive and well and doing great things. And if she came to the archives, she could see that the hospital hasn't forgotten the memory of her dad.
Having my father's name attached to something as important as a blood center where healing takes place, amazing medical discoveries, it's a powerful legacy. And one thing I've learned from this journey is that the only thing that really endures when you're gone is the kindness that you've shown to other people. That's really about the only thing that stays.
Like the hero in a timeless tale, Leanne Walker Young's voyage of discovery has led her back to a very familiar, comforting place.
It was ironic that the tape was found at home all along, but it reinforces to me that the journey was more important than the tape.
Good job.
You know what? Your granddaddy would be really proud. The treasure was the journey and not the tape.
Last night, the daughter of former Chicago Cubs coach Verlon Rube Walker revealed she had just heard a recording of her late father's voice for the first time. We told you the story of Rube Walker and Lee Ann Walker Young in November 2013, so you may not remember it, so let me go through it again pretty much word for word. Verlon Lee Rube Walker was a career minor leaguer in the Chicago Cubs system from 1948 through 1962, playing or managing in places like Paris, Illinois, and Lumberton, North Carolina, and Wenatchee, Washington. And then they brought him to Chicago to become a Cubs coach at first base or third base, sometimes in the bullpen, eventually a pitching coach like his brother in New York. And thus he served through the 1970 season, gaining friends and doing his job and helping the Cubs' resurgence and suffering through the collapse of 1969 and forever having to explain why. He and his brother Al, who was the pitching coach of the Mets, were both named Rube Walker. The explanation was Al Walker had been the bat boy for his hometown team in Lenoir, North Carolina, and its star and his hero was a player named Rube Robinson. So Al was nicknamed after Rube Robinson, and Verlon, 3 years his junior, was nicknamed after Al. But then Verlon Walker was diagnosed with leukemia, and on March 24th, 1971, just before the start of that season, he died. He was just 42 years old, and his daughter Leanne, who could still have sat comfortably on his catcher's mitt, was just 3 years old then. The baseball world mourned deeply. There is a stadium named for him back in North Carolina. There is a blood center named for him at the hospital at Northwestern, where his illness claimed him. They mourned. They mourn still, even in New York. I remember that. The Mets' Rube Walker was universally respected, and thus so was his brother, and so we grieved too. Verlon Walker's daughter missed countless things growing up without a father. She seems to have adjusted as well as you could. She has a family of her own, two boys. On right, that's Christopher, and on the left, that's Walker. He's named for his grandfather. But there was one thing Leanne could not get out past. One eternal, indestructible link between parent and child that had been destroyed. We live in a time when everything in sports is recorded and kept, digitally or on video or on film or even still on tape and vinyl. It is impossible to realize that things from just 44 years ago might not have been recorded. Leanne had no recording of her father's voice, and having been just three when he died, she had no memory of it. Such a simple thing, and so little to ask for, and such a needle in a haystack the size of the world. Several years ago, she set up a website, baseballlovestory.com, about baseball, about her father, about her quest to find a tape of him talking. And she began to write a blog, and she began to write a book, and the hope was somewhere, some stranger would remember, oh yeah, We did a broadcast with Rube Walker of the Cubs in 1969. It's out in the garage. Boy, was Leanne Walker Young in for a surprise, because she has now heard her father's voice, because suddenly somebody did remember a broadcast, and not a stranger. Her mother. As Leanne wrote on her blog last night, my mother contacted Joe Parker, a local pastor who knew my father well. He remembered that my father had invited Bobby Richardson, New York Yankee second baseman and fellow Southerner, to speak at South Lenoir Methodist Church in 1966. The service was broadcast on WJRI, Lenoir's local AM radio station. Joe Parker had a recording. My mother had it transferred to a CD. On the recording, my father introduces Bobby Richardson. Simple as that. She received the CD last Saturday, she listened to it by herself, and she had the kind of reaction that you can probably imagine. Not much to the recording of her father's voice. The one she finally heard after 44 years of waiting was just a minute and 10 seconds long. Oh, you'd like to hear it?
We're very fortunate to have with us this morning Bobby Richardson, a great second baseman for the New York Yankees for many years. I told Bobby that this was great Yankee territory, so he can feel at home. And also, I'd like to introduce his daughter, Christy, sitting down here in the office. Christy, would you stand up, please? Bobby was a great baseball player. Been this is Yankee territory. I guess I could be here all day trying to tell all the great days he had on the baseball field. And most of you Yankee fans would already know about it. So I'll not try to attempt to tell all the accomplishments that he did on the field. But Bobby has also had many great days off the field. Bobby was a great leader on and off the field. He very active in youth groups, various religious groups. And in my lifetime, I guess Bobby is the most respected player in baseball.
Just 70 seconds. But time is not just, as Einstein revealed, a relative thing. It's also a funny thing. 70 seconds traveling across 44 years. The tiniest of triumphs for the way we would like things to be over a universe that usually seems disinterested. 70 seconds of healing. 70 seconds of a needle in a haystack the size of the world. I'm not done, Leanne Walker Young wrote yesterday. I will continue my quest, listening to stories, finding images, searching for more audio, video, and completing my book. Most importantly, I plan to share what I have learned with other women plagued and blocked by grief, urging them to embark on their own soul mission. And I have a date with Bobby Richardson. I'll let you know how that goes. Congratulations, Leanne, and good luck finding that next tape of him.
Hi, I'm Bill Tate with Caldwell County Now and Then on Facebook. If you like what we do at Caldwell County Now and Then, please donate to our local museum, the Caldwell Heritage Museum, 112 Vaden Street, Lenoir, North Carolina. Thank you.